Welcome to Listening to the Future, the evolution of podcasting and digital audio virtual event hosted by the Georgetown Entertainment and Media Alliance and the Georgetown University Alumni Association. Thank you for taking time out of your day to connect virtually with fellow Hoyas for today's conversation. Before we get started, we would like to share a few tips and reminders. This conversation is being recorded and the recording will be made available on our YouTube channel, and you will receive the recording link in a follow-up email. Please send in your questions as you have them using the questions section of the webinar control panel. We have a full discussion planned today and may not have time for many audience questions, but please still submit them as you have them. If you're having any technical difficulties or other issues, please submit these concerns also via the questions section. To kick things off, I'm pleased to turn things over to Grace Kane, a 2011 graduate of the Georgetown College and the Director of Business Development at Simplecast. Grace, over to you.
All right. Hi, everyone. Yes, my name is Grace Kane. And yes, I graduated in 2011. And yes, that means I was supposed to have my 10-year reunion last weekend, which I'm still recovering from the fact that we were not there in real life. But I'm super excited to be here tonight. This event actually evolved out of some of the planning that we did earlier this year for the Gemma externship program. So if anyone, you know, who's on here would like to get more involved in that, feel free to follow up with us and also make sure that you subscribe to the GEMA newsletter. So we wanted to kick off tonight's conversation by setting the stage on podcasting as a medium, which is hardly new, but its rapid acceleration has really been hard to ignore in the last 2 to 3 years, especially if you're really involved in the media industry. A couple stats. Today, there are over 2 million podcasts in the ecosystem, and there are now around 118 million monthly podcast listeners, which is up 12% from last year alone. This rabid and engaged listenership has drawn over 13,000 brands into advertising on podcasts, and overall ad revenue is expected to reach over $2 billion by 2023. So while advertising has been the primary form of monetization, there are also a lot of new avenues for revenue that are continuing to evolve. And in fact, just yesterday, Apple Podcasts launched subscriptions for podcasters for the first time ever. So we're seeing a lot of established Hollywood talent, traditional media companies, sports legends, cultural icons, even former presidents have been jumping into this medium head first. And they join a growing contingent of passionate, diverse, very entrepreneurial, independent creators who have been growing and engaging their audiences on different platforms, including through audio. Today, there's truly a podcast for everyone. And the folks here tonight are leading the way in both creating the world's biggest podcasts and also opening up avenues to empower creators to create their own. So with that, I'll pass it over to Tom to introduce himself and all of our amazing panelists.
Thanks, Grace. Good evening. I want to thank the over 300 attendees who are joining tonight. It's so exciting to have such a big crowd. My name is Tom DiNapoli, college class of 2001. So this would have been my 20-year reunion this year. And I am the chief strategy officer of APM Studios, which is the podcasting division of American Public Media. I'm really excited for the panel that we have tonight. We're really fortunate to have a blend of people who can speak to the management, leadership, executive part of the industry, to the journalistic part, editorial, and to creative entertainment and development. So as a strategist, my job is mainly to kind of listen and to learn from what's happening. And so selfishly, I love moderating these panels because it's such a great opportunity to learn from leaders in the field. Last year at this very time, I was at Viacom CBS and I was moderating a panel that was kind of more aligned with the time. You know, COVID, political and social turmoil was happening, economic uncertainty. And so we were talking a lot about resilience and overcoming challenges. And now, you know, 1 year later, as the country is ostensibly opening up more, we're talking more about recovery, it seems like a perfect time to talk about growth and opportunity. And digital audio and podcasting feels like a really good industry to have that discussion around. So really, without further ado, I'm going to ask everyone on the panel to introduce themselves. And I'm going to prompt because I know it's kind of hard to go around the horn on these things and in alphabetical order. So Conal, I'm going to start with you.
Sure. I'm Conal Byrne. I'm the CEO of iHeartMedia's Digital Audio Group, which oversees all the stuff that iHeart does in digital, and part of that is podcasting.
Great. Liz?
Hi, I'm Liz Gateley. I'm a senior advisor at Spotify, overseeing original podcasts and video. And happy to be here. I have a daughter, Isabella, currently at Georgetown.
Phoebe?
Hi, I'm Phoebe Lett. My day job is producing a podcast in the New York Times opinion section called The Argument. My night job is, my hobby job, as I like to call it, is trying to get podcast coverage and recommendations into the New York Times any possible way I can. One of them is I run the New York Times Podcast Club on Facebook, which I created in 2017. Yes, because S-Town was just come out. Yes, 2017. So
great podcast. Kai.
I'm Kai Ryssdal. I'm the host and senior editor of Marketplace. I also do a podcast with Molly Wood called Make Me Smart. Got my master's at Georgetown way too long ago, and my oldest son just graduated from college last year.
If I could do a plug for Make Me Smart, that's been my favorite podcast during COVID. I really adapted to it at that point. Everyone here should definitely check it out if you're looking for a recommendation after. I'm not just plugging because I work in the same company as Kai. And finally, Suzanne Grimes unfortunately had a family emergency and was unable to attend today. But if anyone has questions that are pertinent to Westwood One or Cumulus, please send them to Grace and I. We'd be happy to pass them along. So I'm going to start kind of basic because I know we usually have people who are attending who are either students right now or getting ready to kind of enter the workforce. And so I think it's always helpful to kind of learn a little bit more about how each of you transitioned from college to career. So if we can kind of go same order again, just to keep it easy, starting with you, Conal, what attracted you to working in media and how did you land your first job in the business after college?
I came at this through the sort of creator path. I was a freelance writer for a while. I was a musician for a while. I wrote film scripts for a while, just dabbling in all different kinds of creativity. I finally landed a job running content for a website based here in Atlanta where I am called howstuffworks.com. I was there for a few years. We got acquired by Discovery Communications right when they were going public. And suddenly I had this sort of air cover of a big, great media company, and I could try a bunch of different stuff. And one of the things I tried was podcasting. We had a great staff of great writers and storytellers. We pivoted a few of them into this 15 years ago, new-ish thing called podcasting. Those were shows that went on to be things like Stuff You Should Know, Stuff You Missed in History Class, and we built a company out of it. But I learned the more business side of the world as I went into these companies, and suddenly I found myself getting acquired at iHeartMedia and running their digital sector. That was my way into it.
And Liz, how about you?
I grew up in Minnesota and moved to LA when I was 10, and that was my inspiration for Laguna Beach, and I never wanted to work in entertainment growing up in LA. I went to UCLA, I went to Loyola Law School, I became a lawyer, and then I worked for the DA, I worked for the Rampart Division, Marshall Clark, during my last year of law school. And then I went and practiced in a private firm, and I realized quickly, wow, this is a very serious responsibility. And I always loved television and film as an escape. So I followed a boy to New York, who's now my husband, and against the advice of all my friends. And I'm still happily married to him. Started in the mailroom at William Morris, which was a great way for me to learn the business and really see the overview of the whole media business. And then worked at MTV, Lifetime, ran my own production company for a few years, and have been at Spotify for 2 years. So really audio is very new to me, but storytelling has always been in my heart, and I'm really, really enjoying podcasting.
Nice. So Phoebe, class of 13, most recent one to be managing this transition. How about you?
Yeah, it was only yesterday. I was an English and Gov double major in the college, which I think is like pretty standard for like, I loved the West Wing. And so I think I want to work as one of those people. And a few internships on the Hill proved to me that I did not want to do that. So I was like, just anything that'll pay me to work in words. And that first thing was a social media internship at a regional bridal magazine that I'm sure everyone here has heard of, New Jersey Bride. But within 6 months, I was like writing 6 articles per issue. I had redesigned the website. I had revamped all of our advertising opportunities, which is all that bridal editorial is. And so they gave me a title of editor, but they didn't give me much more than $8.50 an hour. And I was like, I gotta bounce. So after a year there, which felt like the right amount of time, I began freelancing and talking to anyone I possibly knew in media. And one of those people was like, there's an opening for a freelance fact checker at the Times in Opinion. If you want, I can put your resume forward. I did that for a few months. By the third time I was on my freelance rounds at the Times, I was sort of cornering people in bathrooms and elevators, asking them how I could get a salary. It felt very important to move out of my parents' apartment. That paid off because I applied for a job that I was woefully underqualified for. That's literally what they told me in the Opinion section, but I had built up enough cachet that it was like, we'll give you a chance. And so I actually spent an hour and a half pitching podcast. This is back in 2014, pitching podcasts that I thought that the Times Opinion should be making. And no one in the department really knew what I was talking about, but they were like, you've got a lot of good ideas. One day, maybe we'll need them. Why don't you take this editorial assistant job? And so I was the editorial board's editorial assistant for 5 years. And during that time, I had a lot of hobby jobs. Most of them were pro bono. Don't recommend going that route. Value your time. But it is how I started that group. And then I became the go-to person in the department. So ultimately, when they did decide in 2018 that they did want a podcast, well, David Leonhardt wanted a podcast, they were like, obviously, Phoebe, you should be on this in your ample spare time. And so a year into that, they made me a podcast producer, and now I'm one of the lead producers on that show.
Great. And I love the reframing of side hustle into to job.
Yeah, just get a good therapist beforehand if you need help.
And I think you definitely have an interesting, you know, path from college.
I think I'm the outlier here. So I when I got out of undergrad, I joined the Navy, and I spent 8 years in the Navy. I flew off the USS Theodore Roosevelt. I worked at the Pentagon for a couple of 3 years. And then I wanted to keep going overseas on the government's dime, but I didn't want to go to sea with what was at that point 6,000 of my closest male friends on an aircraft carrier. So I took the Foreign Service exam. I spent 4 years in the Foreign Service. And at that point, the woman who would eventually become my wife and I decided we wanted to get out of the Foreign Service. She wound up in the Graduate School of Business at Stanford. She is the brains in the family. And I got a job at the Borders Bookstore in Palo Alto, California, which is now, I think, an Apple store. And one day she sat me down and I was miserable, right? I was 34 years old, about to have a baby, freshly married, and had no idea what I was going to be when I grew up. And she sat me down and said, listen, you need to get your head out of the sand, except she didn't say sand. And I think you should try journalism. You're this weird news freak who gets up at 5 o'clock on a Saturday morning to get the New York Times off the front stoop, right? When it still came to the front stoop. And you should give it a shot. And in all honesty, I kind of blew her off. But I eventually wound up getting in touch with the senior editor for news at KQED, which is the public radio station up in San Francisco. Very long story short, I took an internship there, cut back my hours at the bookstore, took an internship at 34. You know, that very first day of the internship, it was me and 5 19-year-olds. But they taught me everything, right? They taught me how to listen for sound. They taught me how to cut tape, literally cut with a razor blade and splicing tape. I hung around KQED for 2 years. They put me on the air after a year. And then right about the 2-year mark, somebody from Marketplace called and said, hey, listen, we've got this job hosting our morning report. You'd have to get up and get out of bed and go to work at midnight and work till 9, but are you interested? And I said, sure. And literally 20 years next month later, here we are.
And so, Kai, since you've been working in audio, I guess radio, you know, before everyone else the longest, what's the biggest change you've seen in the landscape over those 20 years, especially as we're kind of moving from terrestrial radio into podcasting and digital?
Yeah, I think the easy answer is barriers to entry are really low, and you can't discount that. But I think the other thing about that that's kind of the corollary is that those of us who pay attention to audio and scripting and voicing and sound and the delivery of the product, realize that it takes so much more than just having a microphone and a computer and figuring out I can do this, right? And look, Phoebe as a producer understands this probably better than anybody on this panel, except maybe me, right? Because I'm useless without a producer. The barriers are entry to low, but the bar for entry is really, really high. It's just, it's way harder than anybody thinks.
And so as the, you know, as the bar raises and as the barriers of entry lower, the ecosystem gets more competitive, more crowded. You know, Conal, how's iHeart standing out as like a legacy media company in like such a competitive field where people can just record in their closet and become a superstar?
I think there's two things that are helping us. One is we are built on the back of really 900 radio stations across 160 markets in the United States. Like, we never lose sight of the fact that at our core, it's thousands of broadcast radio talents, from the Breakfast Club morning show in New York to Ryan Seacrest, to Bobby Bones, to Elvis Duran. Like, these guys have honed the craft of broadcast radio better than most. All of those guys are now podcast stars too. Some of those biggest podcasts that we distribute start out every day as broadcast radio shows in the morning. It gives us also a massive platform to be able to launch new shows. It's hard to live anywhere in the United States right now. And if you listen to the radio today and you hear an iHeart radio station, you're probably going to hear a 30, maybe a 60 second ad for season 4 of the Ron Burgundy podcast. That's because we bring to bear all of the marketing we can when we launch something like that. I think the biggest learning for me being acquired by a broadcast radio company coming up as a podcaster is the power of that broadcast radio marketing. iHeart reaches over 90% of American adults a month. I didn't know that before I worked at a radio company. I didn't know, very candidly, that broadcast radio had that mass reach on the level of, yes, a Facebook or a Google in the United States of America. And to be able to use that to launch new shows is awesome. It means that you can launch established talent into the medium like Will Ferrell, but it also means you can launch new talent like Jess Hilarious, an incredible new Black comedian that we launched in a podcast network we launched called The Black Effect last year. Incredible. Now she has a 500,000 to a million download a month show because of that marketing machine. So that's helped us a lot to cut through as it's definitely getting more competitive.
So even, you know, even as we're enamored, or the media that covers the media is kind of enamored with breakthrough new technologies and digital disruption, the power of having, I guess, linear or, you know, terrestrial broadcasting is still a major differentiator for iHeart.
It certainly helped us, yes. I mean, when you think about it, we throw at new launches and established titles over $100 million a year of in-kind broadcast radio marketing. That helps. I actually don't think it just helps our shows. It's not like we're taking credit for the whole industry. There's something happening in podcasting, period, but I actually think it's helping the medium grow. The number that we threw out there at the top, you know, 120 million Americans a month listening to podcasts, and that up 12%, I think, year over year, that's bonkers. What's even more bonkers is it's 80 million Americans a week now listening to podcasting. That's the moment for me that you stop down and say, hang on, something just happened that doesn't happen very often. You have a new content type. It's borrowing from older mediums. It's using new technologies, but it's a new content type that actually has reached, maybe permanently, mass reach audiences. If you think about all the content types that come and go, they usually come and go. They usually settle into a sort of a niche usage like VR. Still sort of figuring out where it plays in our lives, but not mass reach yet. That's what's weird about podcasting, is it doesn't seem to be doing that.
And last follow-up question for you, what do you think is the barrier of entry, or what is, I guess, preventing more people from finding podcasts faster? This is, to me, to a lot of us, I think it's been like second nature, been listening for like 10 years plus. What's the hurdle for other people?
Simple answer is the companies out there that are the best at sifting through and surfacing content aren't yet truly in the podcast medium. Facebook, Google search, even YouTube. it's kind of weird when you think about it. The most amazing thing about podcasting is that it's hit this 120 million Americans a month, 80 million Americans a week, sort of air quoting here, on its own. It's done that without the benefit of the distribution platforms where you usually find and share content, like Facebook and Google search and YouTube. Just now, Facebook is starting to launch ways to integrate podcasts into Facebook, but that's in 2021. We're 15 years into a medium. So without being maybe too wishful here, I actually think some of that discovery challenge in podcasting, where it actually is, we hit peak content really fast in this medium. I actually think some of that discovery challenge will get solved as Facebook and Google search start to treat this like a first-class citizen. Their words, they've literally used these words of like, we're going to start onboarding this medium a little more, integrating it a little more above the fold in search results. That'll probably start to solve some of this discovery issue. I think a big change that happened right when COVID hit that slipped off a lot of our radars, Google updated its search engine such that there's now a podcast module that appears above the fold when you search podcasts. These tiny changes are seismic in the way that we discover and consume content. I think that'll help, Tom, but no, first 10, 15 years, you had an explosion of content, and it's almost like the discovery and search engines couldn't handle it. We're probably going to come out of that now.
Thank you. And Liz, so I feel like every other week, you know, we read about some blockbuster deal that Spotify does. I think this week was Call Her Daddy, the $60 million three-year deal. Outside of the ability just to marshal tremendous amount of capital to invest in new shows or acquisitions, what is it at Spotify that's differentiating you from other companies in the audio space?
Well, I think we have music listening and your podcast all in one space. So for a youth, a more 18 to 34 year old audience, you have everything in one place, which is significant for our users. We've also been able to, I mean, we've some of the best engineers on the planet for machine learning, but I think some of our formats like your Daily Drive and Music and Talk have really driven a lot of great growth with partners like iHeart or the New York Times people making short form news for us, so that we're using the algorithm to personalize music in combination with people's morning news listening. That's been tremendous for us as a platform. And I think we've had to scale very quickly because we were fairly late to the game. So obviously a lot of the big deals we've done have been about acquiring companies that already were at the top of their game, Gimlet, Parcast, The Ringer, and buying categories, sports, crime, and sort of, we always call HBO Gimlet, the HBO of podcastings. So for us, that's been exciting, and now we're focused on, we're lucky that we get to work with all of the partners here on this video chat to host all of iHeart's and everyone here's podcasts. So for us, exclusives is going to continue to be probably fewer and bigger, and focus on the discovery and all the improvements we need to make as a distributor.
Great. And so Phoebe, I guess similar to Kai, when I was 33, I was kind of having this come to Jesus conversation with my wife about, all right, spent my 20s, early 30s doing one thing, you know, what am I going to do next? And the first course I took as transformational was product management. And in that course, we studied the New York Times Innovation Report from 2014, which is kind of like the blueprint for how do you take a legacy media organization, especially at a time when newspapers were suffering, and pivot it towards the future. So you're kind of in one of the companies that, at least from the outside, seems like, you know, you're achieving some degree of escape velocity. You know, you managed that turn. What is the secret sauce of the New York Times, or what is it about the New York Times that traditional media organization you've been able to round that corner?
Well, I should say that we've been able to do that not necessarily at the expense, but certainly at the loss of a lot of local reporting. So a lot of people cutting down on where they subscribe and deciding that the name brand company, which is great for us. We have been able to survive, and our competitors have followed us with the paywall, with the various ways that we've made it worth our audience's while to give us money, whether that's, you know, through apps. Everyone loves the cooking app. Everyone loves the crossword. These are brilliant. They are not journalism, but they are brilliant. And so we're actually quite a diverse company beyond journalism. And podcasting for the Times only was sort of a sleeper in that. It definitely was not in the 2014 report as part of the strategy. And I was part of the very small, you would be shocked if you've worked on an audio team, how small of a team for the run-up, which was the podcast that Michael Barbaro hosted before the Daily, and it was in the run-up to the 2016 election. And out of that success, they realized they had both a good host, but also a pretty sellable product here. And so out of that came the Daily, and the Daily's outlandish success is what has sort of retooled the company's way of thinking about audio, which is great if you're me and you love audio more than any other medium in the world, because it means that people are willing to take a lot more risks, like my own department, the opinion section. We have 3 podcasts now. We're developing another one. And so, yeah, so how did we survive? You know, it's interesting. I think journalism aside, The Times considers its biggest competitors to be any drain on your attention. So Instagram, Netflix, and that's sort of how they, as a company, set their sights on how they can attract your attention and what times of day they can attract your attention. And journalism itself is something that you might select for certain parts of your day, maybe your morning. I certainly want to get read in on everything, like Kai mentioned. But then later in your day, you're going to need to cook dinner, or later in the day, you're going to need to relax with some crossword puzzles. And so, again, it's like fitting ourselves into your life in a way that kind of makes us, you know, impossible to put away, to put down. And that's been really interesting as a person who considers himself a journalist and an audiophile, is like, oh, okay, we're actually like really trying to be everything to all people. And fortunately in audio, it means that, like I said, people are taking more risks. We're developing, like, what does a op-ed show, what does an opinion sound like in audio form? We have a few, like I said, I'm on the debate show. We have a few interview shows, but like sort of the sky's the limit. And it's only that way because of the outlandish success of the Daily that we're able to try so many things. But I will say, just, you know, going from a small regional journalistic outfit to this one, people, just the power of the label, the power of the Times is just cannot be understated in any way, in any form of like legitimacy, but also like our podcasts can be a lot more successful because they're from the Times, and that's just what it is.
So similar to what, you know, what Conal had said about the power of having, you know, that terrestrial radio reach with the Times, the differentiator is the power of the brand, that legacy brand is actually what helped you manage this kind of turn into a new medium.
Absolutely. And it's also, it's a high standard that I think everyone that works at the company consistently agrees in the surveys that we have to take as employees. Everyone across the board, like 100%, believes in the mission and also believes in the need for, you know, damn near perfect work. And so, like, what is the highest quality that we can provide? And that's sort of the guiding light behind all of the journalism and all of the products that we put out.
So Phoebe, as one of the people who is at the tip of the spear of podcasting in your organization and someone who's like an early adopter to it, you know, where do you see it now going over the next 5 years? Like what's the biggest change that you anticipate over the coming years? And I personally hate these types of questions because it's like crystal ball thing, but just where do you see things kind of moving right now? Let me interrupt you 1 second. Where do you want your side hustle or hobby job to be in next?
Okay, these are very different questions.
Yeah, I think that's the better one. Where do you want the side hustle?
I was going to say, I need to answer that as the two different people that I am, which is there's the company answer that I'm supposed to give, and then there's the, like, I am actually a pretty shrewd observer of companies that make audio, and I like to report on them sometimes. And so those are two very different answers. And so my dream, you know what? Say it into the world. My dream is that the coverage of the Times, this is, again, speaking of my hobby job, the coverage of the Times would take podcasts and audio art, audio drama, as seriously as it takes dance, music, theater, movies, and television. So that is my personal dream. And I quite literally send people emails that I've never met throughout the company every week to try to make that the case. This is perseverance is the key. I'll get there. I would also love to just be an editor of the coverage. And there's so many really cool critics and journalists covering podcasts that I think would make, I've seen, and I've also been told within the space, like, every time the Times writes about podcasts, it legitimizes them a little bit more. And you can honestly count on one hand, like, just a few years ago, how many times we mentioned podcasts or podcasters. I sometimes get frustrated, no shade to anyone on the panel, but I sometimes get frustrated when we only focus on celebrity hosted podcasts or things like that, because I do consider this like a medium, an artistic medium, and I have such admiration for terrestrial radio, like, you know, reporters, radio reporters on the beat who are making incredible storytelling come to life. So that's my personal dream. Where I think that our company and the industry is going is definitely, like, as we mentioned earlier, Apple, the subscriptions, figuring out monetization for all of those eyes. Like, we've been giving out these products for free for a really long time, and it's wild. Like, it's wild in the era of the streaming wars that anyone would be giving away products for free. I mean, Stitcher has
public radio, right?
I know. Well, this is the thing. See, this is the thing. You're used to just, like, throwing it out there and being like, hope you like this. I gave my soul to make this, but I hope you enjoy it. And maybe you didn't catch it, especially if you're terrestrial radio. Maybe you didn't even catch it when it was on, which is a great thing about digital. But yeah, I think figuring out a way to harness the audience, which, as everyone here has mentioned, is just, like, chomping for it. And Spotify has a great model of anyone can listen. You don't need to be a subscriber, but gosh, is it easier if you are. And so here you go. And Apple's coming into this space. We learned with Luminary that people aren't necessarily going to download a new app and pay for that just based on names alone. So it's figuring that out, I think, is probably the task of people far above my pay grade. But I look forward to thinking critically about their choices.
And Liz, what about you? Where do you see the biggest change happening?
Well, I think I hope, like Phoebe said, that it does get recognized more and across the business as well. I find I'm probably the last call on an agent's return list and a lawyer's pile of deals to get done, because they all work on percentage and the money is not here. So I'm often like, well, here's why it's great for your client to do this. And we've waited a year and a half to close deals. And so I hope that the value of the talent and the IP that it's creating gets seen equally with films, because it is as valuable. And I think it's reaching, as everyone said, as many, if not more people than linear television is on a daily basis. I think that discovery, monetization, SAI, DAI, all of that is continuing to improve and needs to continue to improve. I think it's going to be really interesting to see those companies like Google and Facebook come in to help with discovery and distribution. Will the RSS feed go away? I mean, all kinds of changes that we're thinking about at Spotify. Is there a different model, the way a lot of our head of R&D always talks about texting and how texting was, you know, SMS feed and then Facebook and Snapchat came along and just reinvented what interacting in a quick chat was. So what's the reinvention with the platform's gonna be? I think it's exciting.
And so Liz, working in the entertainment space especially, you know, movies and television have always been hungry for IP from other mediums, magazine articles, comic books, regular novels, books. It seems like in recent years, there's been a big uptake in podcasts kind of crossing over to TV series, Dirty John from Wondery, Gimlet's Homecoming, Slow Burn from Slate. As TV and film has kind of been shut down for about a year and a half, and it seems like, you know, they're getting ready to kind of come back, and they're kind of gearing up with IP. First, what are some of the reasons why you think podcasts have been so successfully adopted TV and film? And do you think that this kind of recovery in that industry, or at least this demand for fresh content, is going to see even like a bigger splurge in spending for podcast rights for series?
Yeah, well, I think it's a, you know, high income, high intelligent audience. I think it's truly books used to be the best storytelling. I truly feel like the best storytelling is in podcasting right now. If you look at Dirty John and The Journalist and Serial, and the way that those are really screenplays when you look at them, the character development, the playing with time change. I mean, those were very long thought out structures of the way that each of those journalists decided to tell that story. So to me, I feel like the best storytelling, first of all, is in podcasts. I feel that, I mean, we're currently shooting in Toronto. We have probably 20 active projects going that are being adapted to television right now. Wind of Change, we're in Toronto right now doing Dolores Roach. We're taking the audio of a non-scripted podcast and animating it for NBC Universal right now, which is really exciting because we're taking the real audio. But I think now, because as Phoebe said, people's attention is what we're all vying for. Anytime that you can find an audience that's rabid for that story already, you're building a funnel of audience that is going to follow it. And if it's a loud enough story, The Dropout, there can be a movie, a documentary, a podcast, and a TV series about it. People just want more of those stories. So did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Tom, let me climb in here for 2 seconds. I think, just to build on what Liz was saying, I think it's the nature of audio as a medium that drives the storytelling. You have to be able to keep people's attention when they're easily doing other things, right? Cooking dinner is one thing, but how many times have you been listening to a podcast, you pull out your phone to check your email or whatever, and you realize you've missed the last 45 seconds of the podcast and you're screwed, right? And you're like, oh man, and then you got to back up and everything, right? It's the storytelling that makes the IP that is generated by a lot of these podcasts so attractive to other mediums, because as you write for the ear, right? And look, I don't know how many of you have been in a radio newsroom or in an audio newsroom, right? When I write Marketplace, I'm speaking out loud and I'm making sure it makes sense. And you have to write for the ear, and that's what keeps the connectivity going in the story. And that's what I think makes so much of that IP really attractive.
So Kai, to follow up on that, and I know I'm mindful we have 5 minutes left, and so I want to ask you a follow-up question and then also Conal before we wrap up. But to that point, you know, knowing we have this audience of people who want to work on the creative side, the editorial side, and you have people like me who are more on the business and management side, as we're on this treadmill to turn out more and more and more content at cheaper, 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 you know, budgets, how would you tell people like me, the business side, to still be able to kind of like nurture and guide people on your side who do need to craft these stories for the year?
So look, I've never met Phoebe Lett before in my life, and I'm not trying to blow smoke, but producers are the heart and soul of what it is that we do, right? We have all, look, I'm talent, right? And I think I'm really good at my job, but we have all heard people hosting podcasts and you're like, how the hell did this person get this job? It's terrible. But the subject matter is really good, and that's all producers, right? I think you're on the business side of this thing, and I think we're seeing this maybe not to the extent they should, Phoebe, but I think we're seeing this in the demand for really good audio producers is way up, because they're the secret sauce, right? They are the secret sauce. And I think that's what you got to have.
And I'm actually going to tie us into your last question, Kai, then. So, because the question is going to be, if you're advising someone starting out in their career, you know, what are some of the, you know, I guess, what are some of the top skills they should start developing, you know, to get into audio and podcasting? But I think you just kind of, this is a great segue to producing, and that seems to be a great path to follow. What are some, I guess, skills that students or people straight out of college should be developing for that?
Well, so look, and this is a better question for Phoebe, right? But there's project management, there's talent management, right? I mean, the best producers I've ever had know exactly what to do with me when I'm being cranky or whatever. And I don't mean to be a prima donna here, but it's a really important skill set. And look, Michael Barbaro, this is off the record, right? I'm kidding. He drives me nuts.
Being recorded, wait.
I'm teasing. Michael Barbaro is really good at his job, but a lot of what he does drives me nuts. But clearly his producers know how to handle it. Same thing with me. So I think it's talent management. And then it's also just strategic vision, right? And Phoebe, once again, I honest to God, this is weird. I don't know you from Adam, but listen, you're saying the right things. That is to say, you have to know where you want to go. You have to have a vision for what you think this medium can be. And right now, as explosive as it has been, we're still so early in this. It's so early. The possibilities, the upside is just, it's crazy.
And Conal, if I could swing back to you in our final 2 minutes here, to go back to the question about where we see podcasts and digital audio evolving in the next 5 years, you work in a company that's publicly traded, you need to kind of report to, you know, the quarter, but you're valued on the future. So what are you going and telling analysts on Wall Street and investors where you see growth for iHeart in the next few years?
I think as we started out this session saying, I think you have an industry that's doubling in terms of its total revenue between now and at least 2023. Ad technology is moving a mile a minute in podcasting. You could almost look at the last 3-4 years of the podcast industry, and it encapsulates the last 20 years of digital media ad tech. Podcasting did all of that in 3 or 4 years, from dynamic ad insertion, audience and geotargeting, attribution, all the things you need to make a medium look and feel like digital media, which is important because now you'll have big brands jumping in and spending bigger. I think you have international audiences start to pick up. I don't know that they reach the levels of US audiences anytime soon, but they start to pick up. But I think also creatively, to what Kai's saying, what happened in podcasting was it defaulted quickly to a either broadcast radio distribution cadence and format or TV. Let's do 12, 13 episodes, you know, like a TV season, or let's do a daily or a weekly chat show like broadcast radio. I think just now what podcasters are starting to wake up to is you don't have to. It's a feat. You can do whatever you want. It's like there really is no rules. So I think you'll start to see people experiment a lot with that. A podcast feed could be treated like an Instagram feed, just with audio assets, 15, 30, 60 seconds multiple times a day, like voicemails dropped in people's phones. There's no reason not to do that. It's one of 100 ways to use a feed differently. I think you start to see a lot of that. And I think we'd be remiss in not mentioning social audio. Obviously, Spotify just launched Green Room. Twitter has Spaces. Facebook has Hotline and multiple new products they're going to roll out. That sort of bridge between, this is about podcasting, but that bridge between audio creators who are alive in social audio and podcasting, I think starts to feed this medium a lot too. I think social audio has a little way to go before it settles into its own. But all of that makes the investor community excited. I think they see audio as a lot of big tech waking up to audio and realizing that we probably don't have any more time for our eyes in our lives. We're on second and third screens a lot of the day, but we have a bunch of real estate in our lives for our ears. And that's going to get filled. It's getting filled with broadcast radio, with streaming music, and with podcasting. No doubt about it. I think that's what analysts are looking at.
Thank you. So we're at time right now. we've packed a lot into 45 minutes. I want to be respectful of everyone's time or all of our panelists' times on here. I hope that everyone who's been listening has gotten something, either whether it's from the creative, editorial, journalistic, business side of podcasting. And Grace and I would be happy to pass along any questions that you might have to our panelists to provide some feedback. So at that, I think we can kind of wrap it up right now, unless anyone has any final words that you want to say. Thank you so much. This is fantastic.
Thank you.
Glad to do it.